on to the next speaker, a native of Augusta, Georgia. Dr. Anderson serves as an assistant professor of teacher education at South Carolina University and campus director of the nationally acclaimed program called Call Me Mister that recruits and trains more black male educators. In 2019, Dr. Anderson was awarded the highest honor bestowed in Call Me Mister, the coveted Trailblazer Award, as well as the ASCD Emerging Educator Leader Award. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome next to the stage, let's give it up for Dr. Rashad Anderson.
Thank you.
No problem.
Hey, when I say Mark, you say leadership, Mark.
Leadership.
Mark.
Leadership.
When I say I am, you say gray. I am.
Gray.
I am.
Gray.
That's right. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I need you to wake up. Get that energy up. Y'all awake with me? All right. Good stuff. I come all the way from the sparkling state of South Carolina. Woo hoo! Came up here to Jersey and it's freezing. Oh my goodness. So I don't have long, but I want to kind of tell you my thought process about preparing for today. So today is all about leadership. And in thinking about leadership, there are certain different aspects that you can talk about when describing what leadership is. We can talk about how to best practice as a leader, how to organize as a leader. But I want to spend today in talking about the aspects of the development of you, yourself, as a leader. Now, I'm from South Carolina, and I grew up in a black Baptist church. And so we're going to do a little something like how we used to do in church. So turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor. See, you ain't doing right. You got to turn to him. You got to say it loud. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor. There's a necessity of the dirt. Oh, good. See, y'all with me today. Okay. I can get an amen. Oh, yeah, y'all with me today. Okay, so look here. I need some folks to shout out to me some people in our country, could be dead or alive, that we consider to be the prime example of an excellent leader. Throw some names. Barack Obama. Michelle Obama. Martin Luther King Jr. Malcolm X. Oprah. Okay. Kobe Bryant. Good stuff. All right. So thank you for all those. Excellent examples of leader. Okay. All right. Now, this is what I want you to imagine. Is I'm going to compare all of those great leaders into an apple tree. An apple tree is essentially a tree that produces fruit. Is fruit nourishment for our bodies?
Yes.
So that means that leaders provide fruit for other people to be nourished from. Come on with me. Now, when we think about the largest apple tree that we've ever seen in our life, what is the very beginning stage of that apple tree? Ooh, yes. A seed. The largest apple tree that produces fruit for hundreds and hundreds of people for years and years to come starts out as a tiny seed, which is why the talk today about the necessity of the dirt is so critical and important. You see, when we talk about a seed, every single person under the sound of my voice has seeds inside of them. Every single person sitting down today has some sort of seed inside of them. But the dirt serves a purpose for the seed. So in burying the seed is phase one. Everybody say phase one.
Phase one.
We have to bury the seed. I want you to think about this now. In order for this tree to produce, it must first be buried. It means it has to be covered under dirt and water and mud, and it has to have resistance in order for the fruit process to begin. You see, burying the seed for me was a process. I want to show you this picture of me. It's not turning, clicking. Of my mom. This was graduation day. I graduated. This was actually when I got my doctorate degree. So I went to University of South Carolina, Columbia. I graduated when I was 26 years old with a PhD. And this was one of the happiest days of my life. But I want to talk to you about the process of becoming an apple tree, because you see, some folks will look at some of the greats of our generation and we forget that they had a process in which they were seeds and they had to be buried too. And so the best way to talk to you about being a seed and being a leader is to tell you about my process of being buried. Because only a few months after this, my mom died. I started my first job teaching elementary school. And when I was teaching elementary school, when I first started, I got a call one day from my mom and she said, "Rashad, I just was diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer." It was my first year as a teacher. At the time, I was in a place in my life, I was in the classroom, I was so upset with the things that I saw in public school and how little black and brown children were being treated, and I was fighting the system, and I said, I got to get out of the system, I got to figure out a way in order to do something about it. And so I started applying to all of these jobs, and I kept getting rejection letters after rejection letters. I would go and apply to speak at these conferences and these places, and everybody say, "You don't have enough experience. Nobody knows your name. You don't have a story. You don't have enough credentials," even with a doctorate degree. Rejection letter. My mother just died. It was a bleak experience. But when I talk to you, next slide, about phase two, is that there is such a blessing in obscurity. You don't want anything before it's time. It's almost like being a baby in your mother's womb. If you try to go for success premature, it's almost like a baby being born premature too. There is such a beautiful process in being buried, because this is the time in which you are collecting the skills that you need for when you get on the platform, you'll be able to manage. You see, I have met some people. One of my friends is a preacher, and he dreamed all day long of being like Bishop T.D. Jakes. And if you know about Bishop T.D. Jakes, he had this mega church. He's on television. He had these thousands and millions and all kinds of people that follow him and support him. But one of the things is you have to honor what you have now with your very best, so that when it comes time, that when your church grows from 5 people in a storefront, if you are effective at that level, you'll know what to do when your church is 5 million. Now, let me translate this for you today. Leadership for you begins now in this process of growth and obscurity. What you must focus on now is being effective at building your craft. And you cannot be worried about getting money, having your name on the front of the program, being super successful and everybody shouting you out on Instagram. This is the time now in which you have to worry mostly about honoring what you have right now been blessed with, which your very best, and being effective at it. Because it's in this moment of time of obscurity, when you're in the dirt, that you're actually learning what it's like to be. Once you get up and you start growing, you can withstand the winds that come to blow you and you won't falter. Y'all with me today? Next slide. See, I am a part of a program called Call Me Mister, and it trains black males to be elementary school teachers. It was so many times as a teacher that I stayed late after work. I gave my own money. I cried. And nobody, I didn't put it on social media. There were so many times that I said to myself, I will be teacher of the year every single year, whether or not I get an award or not. It's because of the conviction that I bring to the classroom. It's because of the passion that I bring to my kids. Next slide. I want you to see. I want to show you this because this is a program in which I was called and invited to be a keynote speaker for. The same organization 3 years prior sent me a rejection letter and said, you don't have the experience or credentials to be at our conference. But you see, when you honor what you are given at your time and you're effective at what you do, you don't have to go out and look for success. Success will find you. This is the most critical part about leadership. You see, when you do things for the right reason and you're really about serving the people and you're really about being effective at what you're doing and you're really trying to do it for the betterment of others and you're good at it, you don't have to worry about being invited to places. They'll look out for you. You don't have to worry about money and all of those things coming. It will find you. Because one thing that I know is that being good, being a servant leader, being passionate and being effective is like a magnet for blessings. Nobody can stop somebody that's effective and passionate. It's absolutely unstoppable. Next slide. But one of the things in phase three that happens is that when a person, they go from being in obscurity and you're down in the dirt, and then all of a sudden you're blessed and then you're elevated again. And you're back on this platform. Sometimes folk will sometimes forget where they come from. Sometimes folk, when they invite them to come places, will say, well, how much I'm getting paid? Why my name ain't the front name on the page? And those are the folks that when we're talking about leadership, they really forget the true purpose of leadership. Service is the rent that we pay for life. Once you become that apple tree, your purpose is to plant more seeds every single place that you go. You see, the people that you called out as the great leaders of their time, they were not known as being great so much for the brilliance that they brought, We know them as being great leaders for the seeds that they sowed in our lives that still manifest today. That's the true purpose of leadership. Next slide. You see, this picture for me, and I'll talk about this in my breakout session, is this is me planting more seeds. Because, see, this was the scene that I saw when I was a classroom teacher. It was black boys in the principal's office all the time, always in trouble. Voices are silent. Nobody listening to them. I'm frustrated. I was in a school building that was built in the 40s, and the first black male that ever was a teacher there. Crazy. Next slide. But when you plant seeds, it's very easy for me to walk into a school building and say, hey, I got mine. I come and I'm getting my paycheck. But when you see that there's a problem, you do something about it. You see, I went to my principal and I said, give me 30 boys in the school that are the worst, the ones that's getting ready to get kept back, the ones that's suspended, the ones that's about to go to alternative school. And I start a mentoring program for them. And this mentoring program, we call it the Brothers Keeper Program. And next slide. And over the years, all of my life, I've been trying to plant seeds in every single place that I go, because I know that when I get this platform, my job really in life is to serve. Next slide. And so when I left the elementary school, I went to SC State University, only black, public historically black college in South Carolina. And I started 101 Black Men. I planted a seed there. Next slide. I took over Call Me Mr. program. I started as an undergraduate, and I came back and I took that over and I planted seeds. So now I touch every single Call Me Mr. that's getting ready to go into an elementary and middle school classroom. I'm planting seeds every single place that I go. Next slide. And then from there, I said, because my platform was elevated, now I cannot just work with 30 kids. Now I can call all of the black boys in the state of South Carolina for a one-day conference called the Brothers Keeper Conference. You see, because the elevation, when it was just 30 boys, I was effective. I didn't have my name in the newspaper. I wasn't invited to places. I was just working and being effective with those boys. And because of that work, somebody say, hey, we want to give you $30,000 to do a summit for all boys in the state. Honor your best with what you got. Next slide. Next slide. And so they tried to bury us. They didn't know we were seeds. I only have 3 minutes. And DJ, if you will. DJ, if you will, I want you to play that song. And I want you to listen. I want you to close your eyes as you listen to the song, because this is one of the songs that really took me through when I was being buried. And then I'm going to talk about it.
Feels so good to make it this far, and I didn't think I could take it so long. There were days I wanted to quit, and I said surely this is it, but I held on. And I've watched as so-called friends turned and walked away, and it hurt so much I didn't have words to say. But even when my day turns to night and nothing seems just right, Lord, I thank
this
you
sign
for,
here
for my life.
It's so important. Mark.
Lord, I thank you.
Leave
for
your mark
victory
on this word.
You
just
I've
like the words of this song.
And all the
if you still have breath in your lungs,
Lord, it was you,
you are blessed.
Me. So
every single person under the sound of my voice right now is a blessed person. This moment was ordained for us to be here and share this moment together. Because one thing that I know, that if you join me, and you join me, and you join me, and you join me, and the people in the back join me as a collective moment and a movement for the good, and we lead this nation and do the right thing, not only will we plant a seed in our garden, but we'll plant a seed around the nation. And when it takes seed in this nation, it will impact the world. Put up one finger for me. All it takes is one. All it takes is you. Be the change. When you make it in this world, drop seeds wherever you go. And this is my prayer upon your life. Make your mark. God bless you. And thank you.
Great job. Fantastic. Thank you so much, guys. One more time for